It would be integral that the now, therefore you apply a Fubini theorem and can produce locally at least.
Is this a trivial or have you done?
That kind of thing is very tricky. Sometimes I think it's not the best way to deal with it. Maybe sometimes we're not touching it. This only when 3-0 you can do something. But it's kind of stuff. Right.
Can I ask that question? For this one, so you have a measure, you have this Borel measure of mu f, where f is an absolute
function. So I'm going to finish what's left class. This little number, I think, is very useful. Someone uses these kind of things for this so-called the J4 kind of thing.
Yeah.
This thing called it.
Yeah.
Like this one's almost only if you were really
for some function five. So.
Yeah, except for this one, you don't. Maybe.
Right, that's that's not enough.
This is so unlike
elements. You have to understand that you can invert because you have that, and then you get a portion time. Yeah. Thank you. Let's recall the place we left last time, and then we try to finish the proof. Recall then we want to prove this lemma, and we want to recall this is equal to sigma L plus 1 of W, and the W is a solution of sigma K of W equal to sum of phi. And of course, W is a matrix Uij plus U delta of Ij. And we want to prove the following differential inequality sigma k of Ij psi of Ij point pool of C1 psi plus of C2 gradient of 2 psi. That's the principle we want to use. And we are under the condition of phi minus 1 of k of ij plus of phi minus 1 of k is larger than equal to 0. So under this assumption. Recall then we compute our sigma k of ij plus psi of ij. That term is less than equal to modulus this one here. That is sigma L of G, phi of I minus, and 1 plus 1 over K, phi of I square of phi, plus minus of K of phi. And then there is one term we still need to deal with that. The term is all those I belong to B, and sigma L of G, phi of I square of phi, minus alpha not equal to beta, alpha beta in G Saint Martin, month 2, G of alpha of beta, W of alpha of I, W beta, and of I. So this one term, and the another term, Gaussian term, the minus. So that's for G. And minus alpha belong to G and sigma here minus 1 G with alpha taken away and sigma K minus 1 G of alpha W of alpha minus squared. So now let me put all these together. So those red box, when you want to prove this red box is less than equal to 0. So that's, once we can prove then this inequality will be done. Okay, because this is by condition we had, under this condition this is no positive. So that is, so now I want to state a lemma. That lemma is what probably will be useful. So now we have this now time, which is G equal to lambda 1 with lambda L, which in of Rn, Rl, and lambda G are larger than 0. Then we consider this function of eta equal to log of sigma k of G. Then we have these following equalities. Then for any the C of equal to the C1 of the C of L, then eta of alpha of beta of the C of alpha the C of beta plus of eta of alpha and the lambda of alpha inverse the C of alpha squared is larger than equal to 0. So is this more or less, this inequality is kind of so-called certain kind of convective property for log of sigma k. Okay, let's examine. So it turns out this red box is following from this the inequality, this red box. The reason now, let's look, recall then, before I prove then, I want to deduce then this red box from here, because let's look phi of alpha, let's take with respect to the lambda of alpha, then what you get will be sigma k of g and sigma k minus 1, g taking alpha away. So now sigma alpha of beta, that will be equal to then differentiating beta variable. Here, if and alpha equal to beta is a 0, so that becomes sigma k minus 2 of g of alpha of beta. Then 1 minus delta alpha beta over sigma k of g, and then you differentiate downstairs minus sigma k minus 1 g of alpha and sigma k minus 1 g of beta and divided by sigma k of g squared. So that is just compute what is it together. Now you can see then that's exact, you put together, you multiply, so you now take C of alpha equal to W of alpha of I in this first special case, because W of I, and then you put it down together, you just compute exactly what that you need. So, and then you multiply C, and multiply, and both sides multiply of sigma A of G times sigma K of G. And then this activity implies this negativity on this part. So just direct computation. So the rest, okay. Then we want to prove this identity. No, this inequality. So now let's just want to have to compute things. So now the proof of the lemma. Okay, so now let's just put things in all together. So then you put this one together, so what we need to prove is the following here. So sigma k minus q g of alpha beta And that's alpha have not equal to, alpha equal to beta, that's zero. So that's alpha not equal to beta. This contrast with that. So PC alpha, PC of beta. And then you also have this. And this, of course, nothing but is sigma k minus 1 and g of alpha, PC of alpha, and square. And so what I'm going to do, I multiply of sigma k of square of g, multiply that, then that this will you have sigma k of g, and then this goes away, so because it's square. Okay, so this is this term. Now let's add this term. This term is equal to of sigma alpha, you have this one here. So that will be, because you multiply of sigma k of square of g becomes sigma k of g. So this is one answer. Then sigma k minus 1 g of alpha. And then you have divided by this. So then you have lambda of alpha of inverse of alpha square. So that's the exact of this the quantity we want to compute. We want to put this as a sign. So you multiply this, okay? So now you derive this out. Sigma k minus 1 g of alpha of c of alpha of square, that is equal to sigma k of g minus 1 and the c of alpha square, that's with alpha, then alpha not equal to beta. Sigma k minus 1 g of alpha, sigma k minus 1 of g of beta, and you can see alpha, you can see of beta. Okay, so now you put two together, so that's alpha not equal to beta put together. Here you also have alpha not equal to beta, you put this together, so that becomes sigma k of g, sigma k minus 2 of g alpha beta, and the minus, because here you have minus I of this, sigma k minus 1 of g, sigma k minus 1 of g of alpha, g of beta. So that you see alpha, you see of beta. And now this the diagonal term, and the subtract with this one, that equal to sigma k of g, sigma k minus 1 of g of alpha, and the subtract of this one, minus something, okay, last one of these, they have divided by lambda of alpha, of inverse, so this have to be here. So therefore, then you subtract of sigma k minus 1 of g of alpha of square, then the c of alpha square. Okay, so just put down things here. So, well, this using of that, this equal to alpha not equal to beta, sigma k of g taking alpha beta, just direct algebraic computation, sigma k minus 2 g of alpha beta, subtract sigma k minus 1 and g of alpha and beta of square. Okay, just direct subtraction, so this equal to that. So now let's look here. But this time, I also want to multiply sigma L of G. So that's sigma L of G all together. And then I multiply sigma L of G. So that's sigma L of G. The reason I don't want to this in upstairs and downstairs. So multiply sigma L of G, that will be equal to and sigma L minus 1, you because divided by lambda alpha, then taking alpha away, sigma k of g and sigma k minus 1 of g of alpha minus sigma L of g and sigma k minus 1 square of g of alpha, c of alpha square. Okay, just this complete identity. So. But now we want to play a little magic here. So So this sigma A of G, I will put this alpha not equal to beta. Sigma A of G equal to sigma A L minus 2 G of alpha beta. Because A L is a full rank, so it's just product all the eigenvalues. So now you pull alpha beta out, then you take these two away, then put here, then this lambda of beta C of alpha times lambda of alpha C of beta. Okay? So I pull beta out from here and pull alpha from here. I pair together lambda beta with C alpha and pair together lambda alpha with C beta. Okay? So now, because by Newton-Mangalore, this is negative. So this is negative, then you increase that will be, you know, I want to use Cauchy-Schwarz. So then increase that, so I use Cauchy-Schwarz, that is A and that is B. A times B less than A squared plus B squared over 2. Okay, so that's very simple way. So that will be larger than equal to, because that's a negative, you increase that, then becoming smaller, because it's negative. So that will be equal to alpha not equal to beta, and sigma L minus 2 G of alpha and beta. And this copy together, don't change anything. And this use Cauchy-Schwarz, that will be our lambda beta of square lambda C of alpha square plus lambda alpha square C of beta of square over 2. Well, because alpha beta is symmetric, so therefore I don't need that, I just take this. Okay, first of all use Cauchy-Schwarz, and then use symmetry, then you just take half of that away. Okay, so this take it. Well, what is this inside here? Well, from here, then what do you do then, because we, okay, use a little space here, sigma k of g equal to sigma k of g of alpha plus lambda of alpha sigma k and lambda alpha sigma k minus 1 g of alpha. So this identity, using this identity. Once you use this identity, you see that this multiply together, this term of that get back to sigma L. And this exact cancel with that one. Therefore, what's left here is plus of summation, then it's of this only this term, so it becomes sigma k of g of alpha, and then copy of this, sigma l minus 1 g of alpha, and sigma k minus 1 g of alpha, and then you have c of alpha squared. So this is identity. So what do you do then? You replace this one by here, and this, so this just copy from all the product with this term. And the product of the rest with this term cancel with that one. Okay, so. But now, let's look at what's inside here. So now, what do you do then? You pull take one beta, put here, then you eliminate this beta, becomes alpha. Because you have beta square. Lambda beta square. So you get one beta here becomes alpha. So now you put the beta inside here, see what's happened. Well, you put beta inside there, that's exactly equal to of this term here. So that's equal to zero. Okay, so that's pure algebraic and it's kind of magic. So that's give you then this lemma. Okay, so the trick here, then you do a little twist and Cauchy-Schwarz, and then you pull things back here. Okay, so this take care about this, what I've been talking about is the joint work in my private some time ago, this dilemma. So that's finished on the convective estimate of the solution to the Christoff-Mingoggi problem. Okay. So any question? So that's it's straightforward algebraic computation, but just at one point you have to make a good use of Cauchy-Schwarz. So nothing there. Just And that just would, because they use that, it took us about 3 months to find out this. Because you need to get something back and put it inside here, and such that identify this one exactly with that. Okay, so now let's take care about what called the crystal Minkowski problem. The reason there is a maybe I just want to want to mention then there is a better way to look at that. When you want to through a hard way, it's complicated way. The reason I went through a complicated way because more or less I want to state this lemma. Turns out this lemma is useful in many other places. Because in those dealing with even Monge-Ampere type equations, sometimes those kind of things happen. You need certain kind of property for the converting of corresponding arithmetic symmetric function. So that's so this maybe I just want to pose a question or problem. So this is in general it's of the following and kind of equation. You have u and u of x. Suppose you have a ellipse equation, this is equal to zero. Then question, so when solution is convex. So that's very simple. That's the info general of this one here. So now suppose we try to follow the very follow the same spirit. So suppose what do we do? Suppose you can connect this equation to a familiar equation. You have deformation path. Suppose something starts as convex. Then you want to prove that around this deformation, and the convexity will be preserved. Therefore, again, you want to use the so-called the constant random theorem. So the question when constant random theorem holds. So the general result in general is the following here. So what do you do then? You think about this function as the following way. As a function, so for any p fixed, then consider this function of this one here equal to zero, of the here of a, and t of x. So a is bound to the positive definite n by n symmetric matrix, and p is fixed, and the t of course is bound to r, and x belongs to something, whatever this equation defined on domain. So now you look at this set. This is a level set of when you prefix this a level set. So if this level set, I call this level of n. So now if n is convex as a level set, convex, locally convex, you don't need all convex. Then, and if u is convex, solution of, I call this equation of 3. Equation 3. Then, and the rank of hashing of u is constant everywhere. So that's in general so-called this constant rank theorem. So that is, you have a level set is convex. That's kind of structure. So now let's look what this can apply to the equation we had. So this equation, original equation, we have sigma k. So of course we are working on Sn is not of domain, so a little different. But anyway, let's look at this equation. So for this equation, it looks like that you can more or less think about this as u, not complete u. Okay, let's think about that way. So let's work on this equation. So over you. So you want to when this is convex. Well, better way to do then you take 1 of k, 1 of k, and then you put a minus 1 of k, minus 1 of k. And that's your f. You can see that f is convex. easy to see the F comment. So therefore, more or less, you see that you want to have that, then F satisfy of this structure condition, called condition of S. So that is condition of S. That's just condition S. And then, of course, you have constant rank. That's exactly what we prove. So it's, if you can use the Bayesian machinery, then it is direct consequence of that machinery. Okay? So that's related to constant rank theorem. But this theorem, in some sense, is very sharp, locally sharp. But if you go back to the equation on Sn, what we had, the equation is global equation. So even locally, you can produce something if this condition is valid. You can produce a solution which is convex locally, but the rank locally is not constant. But the problem here, then, of course, we use something, a big machinery, to produce the convexity, probably maybe not the most effective. So the question again, and what is necessary in specific condition? Find and the necessary and sufficient condition for convex solutions for when k is less than n, less than 1. So that's, I think, is one of the problems still outstanding. So now let's move to a different category. So then we want to look at another type of equation that's related to so-called curvature type estimate. What we have done here for this kind of problem, we did so-called hashing type estimate. The hashing type estimate is a little different from curvature type estimate. So now, again, we will see that this also in a very similar spirit to explore certain convexity or concavity property of elementary symmetric functions. So now, the problem, Alexander problem, will prescribe curvature measure. So recall the k's curvature measure, or M one the k's curvature measure. For a convex domain, convex upper surface, N plus 1 is defined of sigma k of principal curvatures d sigma of and n. So that is the measure. Okay, so that's d mu. Okay, that's k's, in my case, elementary symmetry. In my case, curvature measure. So now, suppose now, so now, recall then the Minkowski problem or Minkowski type problem, more or less you want to find the inverse. So give you something you want to recover. So when you get a half surface such that corresponding Gauss curvature is equal to the function prescribed on Sn using the normal correspondence. But as end of problem here is not normal correspondence, it's radial correspondence. So now you have a half surface of M of N in of Rn plus 1. Now suppose you pick an origin inside of the body. Now you suppose now you take a radial direction, and that is your of vector of x, and then you think about this as if this is star shaped. Suppose the m is star shaped, then of course everything with complete control, then x will be equal to of a rho of x here x belongs to of Sn. Okay, radial correspondence. Recall then, yesterday we did so-called normal correspondence, and a xenomorphism is a radial correspondence. So then, of course, through radial correspondence, you want to recover of subsurface. Okay, so now the problem is then given of and a metric mu k mu maybe it is risk k k now is fixed mu and which is equal to of f d sigma of S n on S n when you find an m of n inside of compact hub surface which is star shape such that and the sigma k of kappa d sigma of m that's equal to d mu, which is by through the so-called radial map. I call this map of R. So x will be a map of R maps x to m. Therefore, then through to the Rm. So that is kappa of here, so d mu, that is defined on n here, then you want to d sigma m, so that is equal to inverse of m, so y, that's on the y, right? You take of inverse back, so that is radial correspondence between all that, it's a general problem. So when n equal to k equal to n, that's original general problem, and that problem was considered by many people. And the difficult part here, actually, this will correspond to the Monge-Ampere equation. And that's solved, I think, by Pogorov. But the C0-Smith was crucial. That was using Triberg and using and a certain kind of geometric consideration against C0-Smith. Because you see that when this of k equal to n, that will be sigma n of kappa, that's equal to Gauss curvature. Therefore, Gauss curvature has to satisfy the confirm condition. You integrate over the Gauss curvature, you have Gauss Bonnet. So that is equal to the area of an Sn. So this thing has certain constraints there, but that's already solved. So here, today we concentrate about a k less than or equal to n, and k equal to 1 is also very easy because that's quasi-linear, so it's not beyond, does not belong to the fully non-linear case. So then we also so now we concentrate about k is larger than equal to 2. So now let's write down the equation. So through radial and the correspondence, the equation will be, of course, you want to have of this. This will be, of course, the Fd of sigma s of n, the radial correspondence. But notice then dm, suppose d, okay, so then the first one, one form of g ij that's equal to, so then I here ij or eij as also normal frame on Sn. Then Gij will be equal to rho I rho j plus rho square delta of ij. And then you can also compute and second Feynman form in terms of rho. Okay. So now in particular, d of sigma of m is equal to of rho of n minus 1 rho square plus gradient rho of square d sigma of Sn. Okay. So we want to use everything on Sn. Sn is a no. Rho is solution is the thing we want to solve. Therefore, now this equation will be of sigma k, our principal curvature, times of this guy, rho n minus 1 rho square plus gradient rho of square equal to of f. Because this has to be equal to this time of sigma k of principal curvature equal to of f time of dz. So this becomes this equation. So that is equation number 4. We want to solve this equation on Sn. Okay, now then you move this back, that's equivalent to the sigma k kappa equal to, and 1 month in over rho square plus gradient rho square, and times of f. That's equal to, and rho minus in plus 1, and the u of f. Here u again equal to the support function of x dot mu, and that's from here you can compute that equal to rho square of rho square plus gradient square of gradient rho of square. Okay, so that's the equation. Well, then this in general can be think about, so this still, maybe before I move on, so that's again this open problem, what you get estimate. Suppose now you have sigma k kappa, the principle and the curvature is equal to something f, which depends on the position, also depends on the normal. So this is kind of this form, because you see that this depends on normal. Okay. So now can you get an estimate of solution for this kind of type of equation? That's still open. So when k is less than of n larger than equal to 3, it's still open. C2 estimate, not n one. N minus one just recent proof. So C estimate is still open. So now maybe I want to just go back to some of the other equations. So this equation very similar to this type of equation, sigma k of kappa equal to just something with f of x. So when k equal to 1, that's mean curvature, and this relates to so-called prescribing mean curvature problem, and that's the Triberg and Wei, and also for general k, Kavarian and Sprague, they have, and all kind of estimate, C2 estimate. So that's followed, this is known. If this is independent of normal. Okay, this is known, and that's by work of Triberg and Wei, and that's for k equal to 1 case, for k larger than or equal to general k, that's Kavarian and Sprague. And they actually work on that for general and some kind of function, that's still true. For example, quotient function, also true. But notice then, this is in general very delicate. So for quotient function, you can produce counterexamples, so that's why it's delicate. Suppose now, let's consider all this, sigma k of kappa over sigma l of kappa equal to of some f of x and mu. And k is larger than l, larger than equal to 1, less than equal to n. Okay. And then this will cause you a problem, because now let's try to do something. So what do you do then? Let's look on the following here. Sigma k of kappa, suppose it's convex. So then sigma, you divide by sigma of n, then this equivalent to C, then that will be equal to of f, then equal to sigma l of kappa of sigma n of kappa. What is this is? Because that's the principal radius, so that's equal to sigma n minus k of w. W is the principal radius matrix corresponding to what we discussed yesterday. And that's equal to sigma and n minus l of w. Well, then let w be w, and is coming from the example of the an example we did yesterday of Alexander. And this, of course, is bounded. So F is bounded because rank, what yesterday, as another example, tell you that you can have a W, which is analytic, no positive, and somewhat positive and definite, the rank on the gray circle is of n minus 1. Therefore, because both of these keys larger than n, A is larger than 1, so both of these support, both are bounded and below and above by positive number. So therefore, this is positive from a general. But notice then, yeah. W and H and kappa are just reciprocal to each other. But you have eigenvalue W touch 0 doesn't mean kappa go to infinity. Therefore, you cannot have curvature bound. Okay? And this is actually negative. So no curvature bound. So in other words, if you want to get a curvature bound, this sigma k is special. So many of the things and in fully nonlinear, if you can do something for sigma k, you can do for some general. But this case is very delicate. So I just want to point out that it's a very delicate. So now let's work on this equation. So this time, because I don't know if I have time still around here, I want to concentrate C2 SMA first. Suppose now, if we have time, I will come back to get C0 and C1 estimate. So this time, we assume, and the rule is, and bound, so assume rule is bound below and above. And the gradient rule is bound. Let's take this assumption. So gradient rule bound is that equivalent to C then, and imply U is bound from below. So now we look on this equation. Recall the equation is kappa equal to of U of rho minus of N minus plus 1 and of F. And so that's in sense, let me just write down of this function. So I want to call this function maybe I don't want to call g. So call this equal to u. Then the rest I'll call this function of c, of eta. Eta only depends on x now. U depends on normal. Because f is function defined of sn, that's related to x. And that's how called related to x. Notice that rho equal to modulo of x squared, modulo of x. The length of the position vector. So that's of x. Here, this guy depends on the normal. Okay? So this is the issue. So now, let's produce a very similar argument. We use this to do so-called the C2 estimate yesterday. Yesterday, for Minkowski problem, we did C2 estimate using concavity of sigma k. So let's try see what happened. Look at this equation, sigma k when alpha k kappa and equal to something mu. So this, I call this say mu 1 over k beta 1 over k of x. So suppose we want to try, last time we tried the trace. Suppose we try a trace mean curvature that's equal to kappa 1 plus of kappa of n. Want to ask the mean curvature, okay? So now, let's try the S-mean curvature. Well, let's compute. So again, we can assume at the maximum point. At the point at 0, then we may assume HIJ is diagonal. In the computation, it makes things a little simpler. Okay? Suppose mean curvature. So now, let's compute of sigma k of ii. Similar what we did yesterday, C of H of II, then using commutator formula, this time a little different of commutator formula, that's equal to of, so H, so that will be equal to sigma k, and of H, Jj of II, that's equal to sigma k of II, and then H, let's commute, Jj, then you have plus H of I H G G of square minus H G G H I of square. Okay. That's a commutative formula. And for the half surface. Okay. So now you contrast that, this will be sigma k of ii, or not sigma k, 1 of k. K of ii, 1 of k of ii, 1 of k of ii, so 1 of k of ii. Then this still there, h of ii, jj plus. Okay, this is homogeneous degree 1, so it's coming back to your sigma k, 1 of k. And then you have HGG square, HGG square. That's the square of second man from 5-man form. Then you have of this, that's equal to minus. And this coming out, this will be sigma 1 to j f, then sigma k, 1 over k of ii of h of ii square. Okay. So this is a basic computation. Then again, last time what we do, we want differential equation. So that becomes sigma k, 1 over k of j, j. And then you make a mistake, then you get sigma k, 1 over k, and alpha, beta, gamma, eta, h alpha, beta of j, h alpha, gamma, eta of j. And then you copy everything here back. Okay, so last time recall, because we use sigma k, 1 of k, concave, therefore this term is larger than equal to 0. That's good news. And then you have of this one here and that one here, and then you hope this one kills that one, but you still have to worry about this. Well, if this is independent of normal, you differentiate twice, you get the most of two derivatives. Therefore, at the most, this suppose so this if this is independent, so that's give back in general. This if this equation independent, right hand side with in of that, then it's okay. But now this depends on mu. You differentiate mu twice, you get square of second man form, and that square the coefficient are not under control. So now you have be careful, because you here you have square. Here you have square, but that square come here may dominate this one. There's no guarantee because you don't know what's the derivative. That's one of the main difficulties here, because you take 1 of k of this. And you, for this equation you compute, you still get something bad. And of course, there is also trouble term up here. Well, for the trouble term here, I want to write down one of the equation here. Suppose now you have support function. So we want to make good support function. Uij is that equal to, and h of ij of l, and x of l plus of h ij minus u h of ij of square. That's for the support function, you have this identity. So now, this hi square, this is also square, then you want to cancel this. And that is known coming from Cavalieri numerous plot. So what you do then, they try all this test function. And this will go away. Will go away. So this term and the cancel eventually with this term contract together. So now what you have here, then you still have this term here. Okay, you have this term here, and then you also have all this. So that's the main thing we have to deal with that. And you don't want to do that, because you threw away this, and too much. And we want to dig in, see what can we get from here. Okay, so this time, instead of taking of case root, we don't do the case root. Just use the standard equation. So now let's again do this again. So contrasting my k of ii with of h of ii, and that come back again very exact same computation without 1 of k. So that will be equal to sigma k of I Laplace, because you here has an IG here, GG, sum of G up, so this could be Laplace of sigma k. Then you have this term, minus sigma k of alpha beta gamma of eta, each alpha beta of gradient, downward gradient of each gamma of eta. And now you have this term plus, but this time have to be really careful because you contract with sigma k. Contract with sigma k, so what do you have? Sigma k of that become k of h of square, because then you have square. And this still there, so that becomes sigma k, k sigma k. Then you minus of sigma 1 and the sigma k of ii, h of ii square. So that is. So now let's do a contraction of this. So you have this then contract of sigma t of I with u of ii, that's equal to, and that's your ii contract, so that will become sigma k with differentiation a of m, a direction x of l, that's plus of k of sigma k minus of u, and sigma of k of ii, h of ii, of square. Okay, well, we don't do that. Instead, I divide by u, I divide this by h. So instead, I want to look at the maximum point of this test function, psi equal to of log of h of u. Sometimes make log makes it simpler. Okay, so you do that, then you will find of sigma k of ii of t of ii that equal to at the critical point that's equal to of the following here. So that's h, and the first derivative complete cancel. So that's h. So that will become some of the plus sigma k minus sigma k of alpha beta gamma of eta gradient of h alpha beta gradient h gamma of eta plus of k sigma k of h of square, and this cancel with that one. You divide by h, this is h cancel, so this becomes this. They divide by u cancel, is that cancel. Okay, so now this divided by h minus of this term here, so that will be sigma k in L variable, then of x or L, plus of k sigma k divided by u. Okay, let's leave everything aside. I want to look on this. Okay, before I do that, let me do a look at this. So that's a dangerous term, sigma k. Well, sigma k equal to this. So that's equal to Laplace of u of eta of x. Well, two things. You differentiate, you have two derivatives. Differentiate one here, you get the gradient, that's okay. The difference this, you get and the linear term of the second Feynman form. So that is okay. So modulus of and h, then you only differentiate it twice. So Laplace u, look what's Laplace u here, is this. So that's equal to, of, you sum up, so that's equal to, and h of l, x of l, plus of h, the plus of u, then minus u of a of square, and h of square, because you take square. So that is sigma k of this equal to this, and then for times of eta of x. And you get the rest will be at the most of h. So linear term h, we really don't care. only then we have to treat so-called quadratum of H. So that's the sigma k of this one. Then now we divide by H, so that's continuum here. So therefore, this equal to of H of L, x of L, divided by H, because you have this guy to divide by H, then the one combines this. So that's, again, sigma k of L, that equal to U of L and eta of x plus U eta of L. And that's, yes, not that good, not important. This gives you that. So I put this term back here, that's minus, and U of L minus U of L over U, because you here you have over U, then you have to multiply of eta of x, this one here. So now let's look at this one. So this is divided by H, that's 1, I will put aside, that's okay. So this is divided by H of U. This also have H of U somewhere here. Let me see, sigma k of H. Right, yeah. So again, U time of that, notice then, U time of eta of x equals to sigma k. So here also have sigma k, U time of the sigma k. So that becomes k minus 1 and sigma k of H of square. Okay, take care of that. The rest will be just, and I have to put this back. Okay, the rest will be of capital O, because you have to divide by H, so then this H will have capital O of 1. Of course, this equal to 0. Use critical point equation, because we have computed with log of H of U. So that's 0 at the critical point. So what's happened here, so this is quadratic term. This is at most, I have to divide by H. So that's a linear term, linear. That's zero order. And if you can pull this is under control, then we are at home. Okay, so the rest won't control this. Now here comes the lemma related to sigma k. Well, let's dig a little more about concavity. We use quotient. So recall then, sigma k over sigma 1 over 1 over k minus 1 is concave. Using of this factor here. So if this is concave, now you compute using the fact, maybe as a fact, this is concave. Therefore, then you just compute. Then you can get minus sigma k alpha beta gamma of eta of H alpha beta of j for any j, H gamma eta of j, this is larger than equal to sigma k. And then sigma k over sigma k of j, k minus sigma 1 of j, sigma 1, then an alpha minus 1. I don't want to use alpha, maybe I use, because I use alpha, maybe I use some, so beta I use gamma, okay, I'm running out. I use, say, S minus 1, I will come back SK, S depends on K, sigma K of J, sigma K minus, and SK plus 1, sigma 1 of J, sigma 1. So that's SK equal to 1 over K minus 1. Just using the concavity, you can get this. Okay, we're almost there. So now let's look what this term gives us. So now recall then sigma 1, sigma k equal to u over eta. Therefore, sigma k of j of sigma k that's equal to u of j of u minus plus of eta of j over eta. But you notice that uj are the trouble term here. Okay? But on the other hand, you see that at the critical point, then uj of u equal to sigma 1 of j of sigma 1. So now you look at this inside. If this subtracts that, you only have this coming out. The mean term goes away. Okay? So this is the most linear. And then you divide by h, then you can put on here. So this term can go away. So it's kind of using the structures and magic structure. Then you get out of this. This goes away. So then from here, of course, we arrive estimate. Curvature estimate follows. So that means then h square, h is bounded by c. At the critical point, then it is bounded everywhere. Okay? So that's taken care. So this lemma turns out also quite useful. So far, you can see then for dealing this kind of equation, we dig out different kind of convertive or concavity properties of elementary Riemann function. And this is also useful in many other places too, coming out very naturally. Okay, so now, so we still have time. So this time, of course, we have up to C2 estimate. C0, C1 estimate, we have to C2 estimate. And then, of course, we use so-called Fourier-linear theory. And having Kirchhoff push everything up. So now we are going to go back to C0 and the C1 estimate. C0 for very easy. So now let's recall that. So let's look at the equation. Equation again, recall kappa equal to of rho minus n plus 1 of u of f of x. Here x is given to us as a. Rho is function of that. Notice then the second, okay, so the Weingarten tensor can be computed as the following here. So h of I and j contract, so one tensor, then h of I and j that equal to g of I k hk of j. So that's because, okay, recall when we compute the curvature estimate, everything was related to so-called the orthogonal frame on the surface. Now we want to get a C0, C2 estimate. Turns out it's better to look as a function defined on Sn. Therefore, from now on, all the current derivative will be with respect to the standard metric of Sn before we use the covariant derivative on the surface. Okay, so Sij get rid of this. Then you can compute what the Hij looks like. Maybe better just copy. So all the derivative, everything with respect to the standard metric of Sn. Okay, first of all, C0. So now you have sigma k. Now at the maximum point, well, at the maximum grading 0, And this is all zero. We're gradient zero. Therefore, at the maximum point, then h of I of g is equal to, that is 1 over rho of cubic, the inside minus rho I j plus of this plus, this goes away, so rho square. Because then at the maximum, minus rho I j is positive definite. Rho I j is negative definite, so this is positive definite. Therefore, h I j is larger than equal to, taking this away, that's equal to of 1 over rho of delta I j. Or delta I j. So once you have that, then you put this inside there. So then sigma k, at the maximum point, sigma k of kappa, and will be larger than equal to 1 over rho of k power, because you have k up here. And then some constant sigma k of identity. And this of course equal to and rho minus n plus 1. But notice then u equal to rho square over rho square plus gradient rho of square of half. So that's at the maximum point, that's equal to rho. Or minimum point the same, gradient equal to 0. So that goes away, that's n. And then you have all this f of x here. So now you put this back here, so that will be move this here, that's n plus k minus k. Therefore, that will be, rho will be bounded. Okay. Because I assume k is less than n. So that will be bounded. And do the same for the at the minimum point, just reverse. Okay? So the same thing, then rho will be larger than equal to say one over here. So that is easy. Well, it turns out the grading estimate is not that trivial. So now we want to find the grading estimate. But this time, probably better to work on not on rho, on of log of rho, gamma equal to log of rho. So now you can rewrite of hij. So hij that equal to e of, maybe better just copy. Minus gamma of omega. Delta I of k, gamma of I, gamma of k, omega square, then minus gamma of k of j plus gamma k, gamma j plus delta k and j. Okay, here omega equal to square root 1 plus gradient gamma of square. Well, this matrix is positive definite, then because notice then Weingart tensor is symmetric with respect to the metric of surface. But now because we fit fixed metric on Sn, so it is not geometric. Therefore, this in general not necessarily symmetric. But to overcome then that this you can take a square root of that. You put this, you can take symmetric symmetrization. Because eigenvalue will be same, because everything related to the eigenvalue. Okay? So this you can take a square root. I call this just take a square root right down this way. And that's not HIJ, but it's essentially the same. So now I'll call this equal to E minus gamma of here B of IJ. And that's the BIJ symmetric. Maybe I use BIJ symmetric. BIJ coming from here. So now instead of then, because of that, then you put on sigma k of B of IJ. Then you move it to the other side. So that's where we get the k power. So that's when e of k of gamma, then omega of k power. And then right hand side originally is, okay, of this one here. So that will be time of e minus n plus 1 of gamma. And u now again equal to e of gamma, then over omega. So then that's the one. Then you put the gamma here, take the gamma over here. And then you have eta. So that will be equal to e and minus n minus k of gamma, then omega k minus 1 of eta. Okay, so that's the equation we have. So now we want to use test function within square of gamma of 2. Then we want to use create a certain kind of weak maximum principle. Okay. So then this time, what I do then, I want to do respect to of this, of sigma k of symmetric function, sigma k of theta of ij, contrast that. So now I want to explain what is sigma k theta ij. Because of doing this kind of symmetrization, sigma k theta ij is take of this as sigma k. So I call this, so B as a matrix equal to B of ij, that equal to, and S of half, and S of half, and know something I call the B theta of ij. So sigma k, and the theta ij, that equal to D sigma k, D Bij theta, and at this, yeah. Okay. Then do this contraction, then direct computation, you can pull then it's the following. It's, you can write down, okay, doing that way because we, so larger than equal to some Cn, m of x, and reading of gamma square of 2, differential m variable in direction, then minus gradient gamma of L, then and D of L sigma K of B, and then add, okay, I have to just write on everything here. Well, notice then, this is larger than equal to zero. This is larger than also equal to zero. So this you can just drop. So that will be larger than equal to, or this is actually equal. So that will be larger than equal to, and at the, so that's true at every point. Now, at the maximum point, gradient gamma square of 2. What we have here, then this two goes away, so then sigma k of theta ij gradient of 2 ij is larger than equal to minus gamma L sigma k of b, and this also drop away because it's okay. So now we want to see what's happened here. So sigma k of b equal to this. Then omega, we call it equal to that. So differentiation of omega equal to zero at the maximum point, because here. So that's, don't differentiate that. Either then defend this guy or defend this guy. So that's equal to minus L. Then suppose we differentiate of this, L must bring down here. So that will be n minus k minus n minus k and gamma of L. and then omega k minus 1 of eta, then you differentiate eta. So that becomes, I still have e minus n minus k of eta, then differentiate eta, okay. I think something stupid, anyway. But eta is a function, is already prescribed. So derivative is bounded. And here, you get here, so then that's give you the first order at the most of, okay. So now let's pull this outside. Omega k minus 1, e or minus n minus k of gamma. So now let's go inside. Inside will be of eta of l, of this. This is bounded, and this will be quadratic, and that's positive. So you have minus minus, and positive, and that gives you the bound. So that will give you the breeding gamma is bounded. So that's taking care of our C1 estimation. And again, we use a very special structure of the equation. So you suppose this C is say sign change, then we're in trouble. So that's different. So this takes care of everything. Okay, so maybe in the rest, maybe I just want to say a few words about the general curvature estimate. For general equations. And this turns out quite important. In particular, suppose, say, when you are concerned so-called isometric embedding problem and so on, suppose you have a surface setting in and n plus 1, so then you have m, which is embedded in n plus 1, then you want to see how regular this surface should be. And that's equivalent to you to control, so that's equivalent so for this, to control the geometry of M, that's equivalent to control the curvature of this M, curvatures of M. So in particular, suppose now the scalar curvature of M is larger than equal to zero. And then you want to control then that equivalent to control the mean curvature. So that's equivalent to control mean curvature. So this type of, at least this kind of techniques is very helpful to do this kind of controls. So that's in particular correspond to the case k equal to 2. Because recall then, for this type of equation, what do we use the special structure of that? But in general, for example, sigma 2 of kappa equal to of f, and that's in general if the normal is involved, then this in general is still unknown, unless when you assume it's starship. So the question is then, suppose now, so that's the problem I want to pose. Maybe there will be a negative answer here. Suppose m of n inside of n plus 1 is smooth and half surface compact type surface with sigma 2 with positive scalar curvature, with smooth positive scalar curvature. Then Then the question is of each is bounded. This bound only depends on here, depends on A. Without starship assumption, that is not known. Okay, a priori. But if you know then the intrinsic geometry of M, then the proof is easier. But for the prescribed scalar curvature problem, that's still not known in general. So you have of this. This is not clear, not known. So starship, if you assume starship is, then yes. So that is. And there are several other problems I want to mention here. So according to the scalar curvature estimate, and then there's another thing here, problem, which is also is a long-standing problem, probably one of the problem in nonlinear elliptic PDE. Suppose now you have sigma k of sigma 2 of kappa that equal to f, which f is larger than equal to c, larger than 0, less than equal to c, 1 over c. Okay, I just changed c very small. So smooth. Is there a pure and interior estimate? In other words, so suppose now this live in the B1, so that's in 4 of radius 1, then the question and the maximum of H at the B of half can be bounded by some C. The C only depends on F. N equal to 2, yes, that's Hahn's result. So for general N, that's still complete open. So that's this related to the scalar curvature. Another problem, let's go back to Chen and Yao. The problem here now, suppose now M is immersed in N plus 1, immersed, and compact again. Suppose the scalar curvature of M is identical to 1. Now, is M wrong? That's a problem that is changing. It's also related to this, and all kinds of things are related. This, of course, global, related to the uniqueness. So, and if you know then of M is embedded, then it is okay. But the problem is immersed. And of course, for the mean curvature, constant mean curvature, there is a counter example by Wendy, famous one. But so far, there's no counter example. So this still is also open. That's the relatives of this curvature equation. This identical to 1. If you can get a good interior estimate, and because right hand side of 1, probably you can produce something. Yeah. So that's also still is open. And there are many other things open. Probably maybe I should stop here now. So this all those kind of curvature equations related estimates and so on, I think there's still lots of things can be digging and many open problems, the questions. Anyway, so I stop here. Thank you.
So what's the reference for some of these estimates? So like that.
This one?
Well, no, the one where you used sigma k over sigma 1 for the 1 over k minus 1, where that trick is used.
Oh yeah, that's in the paper. Okay. Those are things, the previous estimate relates to the joint work with Jin Fang Li and Yin Li and myself. I think that's in 2008 or 2009, remember, that's there's only one paper joint three by us. So the related curvature measure problem. That took about 10 years. So that's things, if you find things that you change everything so easy. And the problem is there's so many and convective or concavity properties of those functions somehow not completely explored. The people more or less because from guiding theory, more or less looking at those rules. That's probably not the right place to look, probably there are some other things.
All right, if there are no questions, let's thank you.